This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book Tropic Death. Author Eric Walrond. Topic: Drought. I whistle blue for 11 o'clock. Throats parched, grim. Sun-crazed blacks cutting stone on the white-burning hillside dropped with a clang the hot dust-powdered drills and flew up over the rugged edges of the horizon to descend into a dry, waterless gut. Hunger, pricks at stomachs inured to brackish coffee and cassava pone, pressed on folk, joyful as rabbits in a grassy ravine, wrenching themselves free of the lure of the white earth. Helter-skelter dark, brilliant black faces of West Indian peasants moved along in pain. The stiff tails of blue denim coats, the hobble of chigger-cracked heels, the rhythm of a stride, dissipating into the sun-stuffed void the radiant forces of the incline. The broad road, a boon to constables moping through the dusk or on hot, bright mornings, plowing up the thick adhesive marl on some seasonal chore, was distinguished by a black animate dot upon it. It was Coggins' rum. On the way down he had stopped for a tot, zigaboo word for tin cup, of water by the rock engine. The driver, a buckra Johnny, English white, sat on the waste box, scooping with a fork handle the meat out of a young water coconut. An old straw hat, black and its rim saggy by virtue of the moisture of sweating sun fingers, served as a calabash for a ball of cuckoo, cornmeal, okras and butter stewed, roundly poised in its crown. By the buckra's side, a black girl stood, her lips pursed in an indifferent frown, paralyzed in the intense heat. Passing by them, Coggins' bare feet kicked up a cloud of the white marl dust, and the girl shouted, "Mr. Rum, you gwine play de guitar t'night, no?" Visions of Coggins, the sky a vivid crimson or blackly star gemmed, on the stone step picking the guitar, picking it with all his hand. Promptly Coggins answered, "Come down and dance de fango fo Coggins' rum and he are play for you. Bajan gal daunty wash air skin till de rain come down." Grumblings. Pitch black. To the washed-out buckra she was more than a bringer of victuals. The buckra's girl. It wasn't T-Sepia, Georgia, but a backwoods village in Barbados. "Didn't you bring me no molasses to pour in the rainwater?" the buckra asked, and the girl, sucking in her mouth, brought an ungovernable eye back to him. Upon which Coggins, swallowing a hint, kept on his journey, noonday pilgrimage, through the hot creeping marl. Scorching, yet Coggins gaily sang, "Oh, you come with yo cakes and yo drinks, evy collection boy over daya. And we go to wa, we shall carry de name Bajan boys for eva." "It are funny," mused Coggins, clearing his throat, "massa braffit and dat chiga foot gal." He stopped and picked up a fern and pressed the back of it to his shiny ebon cheek. It left a white, ferny imprint. Grown up according to the ethics of the gap, Coggins was yet to it a queer sado man, given to the picking of a guitar, and to cogitations on the step after dark, indulging in an avowed juvenility. Drunk with the fury of the sun, Coggins carelessly swinging along cast an eye behind him. More of the boys from the quarry, overalled, shoeless, caps whose peaks wiggled on red, sun-red eyes, the eyes of the black sunburnt folk. He always cast an eye behind him, before he turned off the broad road into the gap. Flaring up in the sun, were the bright new shingles on the Dutch-style cottage of some Antigua folk. Away in a clump of hibiscus was a mansion, the color of bilgy water, owned by two English dowager maidens. In the gap rock stones shot up, obstacles for donkey carts to wrestle over at dusk. Rainworms and flies gathered in muddy water platoons beside them. "Yo damn vagabond yo!" Coggins cursed his big toe. His big toe was blind. Helpless thing. A blind big toe in broad daylight on a West Indian road gap. He paused and gathered up the blind member. "Isn't this a hell of a case fo yo, saw?" A curve of flesh began to peel from it. Pree-pree-pree. As if it were frying. Frying flesh. The nail jerked out of place, hot bright blood began to stream from it. Around the spot white marl dust clung in grainy cakes. Now red new blood squirted, spread over the whole toe, and the dust became crimson. Gently easing the toe back to the ground, Coggins avoided the grass sticking up in the road and slowly picked his way to the cabin. "I stump me toe," he announced, "I stump me toe, woy woy. Go bring yo pappy a tot o' water. Ada quick. Dusky brown Sissy took the gourd member in her lap and began to wipe the blood from it. Pappy stump he toe. Dem rocks in de gap. Mine and e got better yet, neater. Hurry up, boy, and bring de lotion. Bring me de scissors, and tek yo fingers out o yo mout like yo is starved out. Hey yo saw. Speakin' to you. Big boy lick yo suckin' yo fingers. Zip. Onion-colored slip of skin fluttered to the floor. Rata Grinna, the half-dead dog, cold dribbling from his glassy blue eyes onto his freckled nose, moved inanimately towards it. Fox terrier, shaggy, bony, scarcely able to walk. Where is dat barrel? Coggins asked, sitting on the floor with one leg over the other and pouring the salt water over the crimsoning wadding. Outside saw. Barrel. What yo day? What yo doin' outside? Answer me, girl. Hey, yo, miss, answer yo, pappy. Hardier's girl. She been eatin' any mo' marl, sissy? She, Ada. Show gal eatin' marl all de afternoon. Pet sugar, no more terms of endearment for barrel. Impatient, Coggins, his big toe stuck up cautiously in the air, inciting Ratta to indolent curiosity, moved past Sissy, past Ada, past Rufus to the rear of the cabin. 2. Yesterday at noon, a roasting sun smote Coggins. Liquid, fluid drought. Solder. Heat and juice of fruit, juice of roasting cashews. It whelmed Coggins. The dry season was at its height. Praying to the Lord to send rain, black peons gathered on the rumps of breadfruit or cherry trees in abject supplication. Crawling along the road to the gap, Coggins gasped at the consequences of the sun's wretched fury. There, where canes spread over with their dark, rich foliage into the dust-laden road, the village dogs, hunting for eggs to suck, fowls to kill, paused amidst the yellow stalks of cork-dry canes to pant or drop, exhausted, sun-smitten. The sun had robbed the land of its juice, squeezed it dry. Star apples, sugar apples, husks, transparent on the dry, sleepy trees. Savagely prowling through the orchards, blackbirds stopped at nothing. Turtle doves rifled the pods of green peas and purple beans, and even the indigestible Brazilian bonavis. Potato vines, yellow as the leaves of autumn, severed from their roots by the pressure of the sun, stood on the ground, the wind as eager prey. Undug, stemless, peanuts, carrots, seeking balm relief, the caress of a passing wind, shot dead unlustered eyes up through sun-etched cracks in the hard, brittle soil. The sugar corn went to the birds. Ripening prematurely, breadfruits fell swiftly on the hard, naked earth, half-ripe, good only for fritters. Fell in spatters, and the hungry dogs, elbowing the children, lapped up the yellow, mellow fruit. His sight impaired by the livid sun, Coggins turned hungry eyes to the soil. Empty cornstalks, blackbirds at work. Along the watercourse, bushy palms shading it, frogs gasped for air, their white breasts like fowls soft and palpitating. The water in the drain sopped up, they sprang at flies, mosquitoes, wrangled over a mite. It was a dizzy spectacle, and the black peons were praying to God to send rain. Coggins drew back. Asking God to send rain, why? Where was the rain? Barreled up there in the clouds? Odd. Invariably, when the ponds and drains and rivers dried up, they sank on their knees asking God to pour the water out of the sky. Odd, water in the sky. The sun. It rung toll of the earth. It had its effect on Coggins. It made the black stone cutter's face blacker. Strong tropic suns make black skins blacker. At the quarry it became whiter, and the color of dark things generally grew darker. Similarly with white ones, it gave them a whiter hue. Coggins and the quarry. Coggins and the marl. Coggins and the marl road. Barrel in the marl road. 6 years old, possessing a one-piece frock, no hat, no shoes. Brown barrel, the only one of the rum children who wasn't tea black as sin. Strange. Yellow barrel. It happens that way sometimes. Both Coggins and Sissy were unrelievably black. Still barrel came a shade lighter. Dadam nuttin', Sissy had replied to Coggins' intimately naive query, Is yo drunk dat yo can tea foam emba me sister-in-law? What had a white pickney foe, ar nega man? Yo don tea foam emba, no? Light-skinned barrel. It happens that way sometimes. Victim of the sun, a bright spot under its singeing mask, Beryl hesitated at Coggin's approach. Her little brown hands flew behind her back. Eat and marl again, Coggins admonished. Eat and marl again, you little vagabond. Only the day before, he had had to chastise her for sifting the stone dust and eating it. Yuri too hard ears, Coggins shouted, slapping her hands. Yuri too hard ears. Coggins turned into the gap for home, dragging her by the hand. He was too angry to speak, too agitated. Avoiding the jagged rocks in the gap, Beryl, her little body lost in the crocus bag frock jutting her skinny shoulders, began to cry. A gulping sensation came to Coggins when he saw Beryl crying. When Beryl cried, he felt like crying too. But he sternly heaped invective upon her. Marl'll make yo sick, tie up yo guts too. Tie up yo guts like green guavas. Don't eat it yo here, don't eat no mo marl. No sooner had they reached home than Sissy began. Eat and marl again, like yo is starved out. She landed a clout on Beryl's uncombed head. Go under de bed, and lay down before I crack yo coconut. Running a house on a dry rot herringbone, a pint of stale yellowless cornmeal, a few spuds yet proud, thumping the children around for eating scraps, for eating food cooked by hands other than hers. Sissy. Dante talked to the child like dat, Sissy. Oh, go along you, always trying to prevent me from beating them. When she gets sick, who gwine ten she? Me or you? Man, go bout yo business. Beryl crawled meekly under the bed. Ada, a bigger girl, 14 and own wayish, shot a look of composed neutrality at Rufus, a sulky cry-cry suck finger boy nearing 20, big head Rufus. Sir, she right, Rufus murmured. Nobody ain't gwine peat me with a hairbrush. I know dat. One leg on top of the other, Ada, down on the floor, grew impatient at Sissy's languor in preparing the food. Coggins came in at 11 to dinner. Ada and Rufus did likewise. The rest of the day they spent killing birds with stones fired from slingshots, climbing neighbors' trees in search of birds' nests, going to the old French ruins to dig out, with the puny aid of Ratagrina, a stray mongoose, or to rob of its prize some canary-catching cat, digging holes in the rocky gap or on the brink of drains and stuffing them with paper and gunpowder stolen from the rum canister and lighting it with a match. Dynamiting. Picking up hollow pieces of iron pipe, scratching a hole on top of them, towards one end, and ramming them with more gunpowder and stones and brown paper, and with a pyramid of gunpowder moistened with spit for a squib, leveling them at snipes or sparrows. Touch bams. Well, Sissy, what yo got fo eat today? Cuckoo, what yo think our have? Lod mo o dat corn mash. Mo o dat prison gruel. People would te ink a man is a horse, a restless crossing of scaly, marl white legs in the corner. Any salt fish? What ours to get it from? Heron? UT Inc. I must be pick up money. Why you expect ma to get it from, with butter and lard so dear, and sugar 4 cents a pound. Yo must be expect me to steal. Well, I ain't de mean no harm. Hey, this man must be crazy. You forget I ain't workin' knee. Yo forget dat I can't even get water to drink, much mo grow onions or green peas. Look outside. Look in the yard. Look at the parsley vines. Formerly things grew under the window or near the tamarind trees, fed by the used water or the swill, yams, potatoes, lettuce. Going to the door, Coggins paused. A 40-leg was working its way into the craw of the last of the rum hens. Laud a massy. Leaping to the rescue, Coggins slit the hen's craw, undigested corn spilled out, and ground the surfeited centipede underfoot. Now we got to eat this, and he strung the bleeding hen up on a nail by the side of the door, out of poor Ratagrina's blinking reach. Unrestrained rejoicing on the floor. Coggins ate. It was hot, hot food. It fused life into his body. It rammed the dust which had gathered in his throat at the quarry so far down into his stomach that he was unaware of its presence. And to eat food that had butter on it was a luxury. Coggins sucked up every grain of it. "Hey, Ada. Rufus tech this. Where is dat Miss Beryl?"
"Under de bed, M.M.
"Beryl?"
"Yassum."
Unweeping Beryl, barely saving her skull, shot up from underneath the bed. Over Ada's obstreperous toes, over Rufus by the side of Coggins, she had to pass to get the proffered dish.
"Take it quick."
Saying not a word, Beryl took it, and sliding down beside it, deposited it upon the floor beside Coggins. "You mustn't eat any more marl, yo hear?" he turned to her. "It will make yo belly hard."
"Yes, pappy."
Throwing eyes up at him, white, shiny, appealing, Beryl guided the food into her mouth. The hand that did the act was still white with the dust of the marl. All up along the elbow. Even around her little mouth, the white telltale marks remained. Drying the bowl of the last bit of grease, Coggins was completely absorbed in his task. He could hear Sissy scraping the iron pot, and trying to fling from the spoon the stiff, overcooked cornmeal which had stuck to it. Scraping the pan of its very bottom, Ada and Rufus fought like two mad dogs.
"You, Miss Ada, yo better don t bore a hole in dat pan, gimme heya."
"But mommy, I ain't finish." Picking at her food, Beryl, the dainty one, ate sparingly. Once a day, the rums ate. At dusk, curve of crimson gold in the sensuous tropic sky, they had tea. English to a degree, it was a right absurdly regal. Pauperized native blacks clung to the utmost vestiges of the crown. Two, it was more than a notion for a black cane hole digger to face the turmoil of a hoe or fork or bill, zigaboo word for cutlass, on a bare cup of molasses coffee.
Three.
"Laud a massy.
What a matta, Coggins?
Say something no.
Massy come hey, and see de gal pickney.
Open yo mout no, what es a matta?" Coggins flew to the rainwater keg. Knocked the swizzle stick, relic of Sissy's pop manufactures, behind it, tilting over the empty keg. "Get up, Beryl, get up, wanna matta sick.
Leaf she up, pappy.
Yo move out o' de way, Mr. Rufus befo'.
Don'ty Sissy, don'ty lick she.
Gal playin' sick.
Gal only playin' sick, dat what de matta wit she.
Gal only playin' sick.
Get up, yo miss.
God don'ty Sissy, leave she alone.
Go back, every damn one o' yo, all yo gwine get in de way."
Beryl, little naked brown legs apart, was flat upon the hard bare earth. The dog, perhaps, or the echo of some fugitive wind had blown up her little crocus bag dress. It lay like a coconut flapjack on her stomach. "Bring she inside, Coggins, wait I gwine fixed a bed."
Mahogany bed.
West Indian peasants sporting a mahogany bed, canopied with a dusty grimy slice of cheesecloth. Coggins stood up by the lamp on the wall, looking on at Sissy prying up Beryl's eyelids.
"Open yo eyes, open yo eyes, betcha the little vagabond is playin' sick."
Indolently Coggins stirred. A fist shot up, then down.
"Move, Sissy, befo' I hit yo."
The woman dodged.
"Always wantin' fo' hit me fo' nuttin', like I is any pickney.
Anybody here this woman would think.
I ain't gwine stand for it, yes, I ain't gwine.
Shut up, you old hard-hearted wretch.
Shut up before I tump yo down."
Swept aside, one arm in a parrying attitude, backing toward the larder over the lamp. Coggins peered back at the unbreathing child. A shade of compassion stole over Sissy. "Put dis to her nose, Coggins, and see what ll happen. A safety da, bits of red cloth." Last year Rufus, the sickliest of the lot, had had the measles and the parish doctor had ordered her to tie a red piece of flannel around his neck. She stuffed the red flannel into Coggins' hand.
"Try dat," she said and stepped back.
Brow wrinkled in cogitation, Coggins, space cleared for action, denuded the child.
"How it all rise?
How, or belly a go up in de year?" Bright wood, bright mahogany wood, expertly shellacked and laid out in the sun to dry, not unlike it. Beryl's stomach, a light brown tint, grew bit by bit shiny.
It rose, round and bright, higher and higher. They had never seen one, so none of them thought of wind-filling balloons. Beryl S.'s stomach resembled a wind-filling balloon. Then, "She too hard ears," Sissy declared. "She went he listened to she pappy, she too hard ears." Dusk came. Country folk, tired, soggy, sleepy, staggering in from town, depressed by the market quotations on bantam cocks, hollowed howdy-do to Coggins on the stone step waiting. Rufus and Ada, strangely, forgot to go down to the hydrant to bathe their feet. It had been a passion with Coggins. "Nasty feet breed disease," he had said. "You, Mr. Rufus, wash your foots before yo go to sleep. And yo too, Miss Ada, I am speaking to yo gal, yo hear me? Talk yo mout off o go head before to box it off." Inwardly glad of the escape, Ada and Rufus sat, not by Coggins out on the stone step, but down below the cabin, on the edge of a stone overlooking an empty pond, pitching rocks at the frogs and crickets screaming in the early dusk. The freckled-faced old Buckra physician paused before the light and held up something to it. "Marl, marl, dust." It came to Coggins in swirls. "Autopsy. Noise comes in swirls. Pounding, pounding, dry Indian corn pounding. Ginger. Ginger being pounded in a mortar with a bright new pestle. Pound, pound. And sawing. Butcher shop. Cow foot is sawed that way. Stew or tough hard steak. Then the drilling, drilling, drilling to a stone cutter's ears. Ox grizzle. Drilling into ox grizzle. Too bad, Coggins," the doctor said. "Too bad to lose your daughter." In a haze it came to Coggins. Inertia swept over him. He saw the old duffer climb into his buggy, tug at the reins of his sickly old nag, and slowly drive down the rocky gap and disappear into the night. Inside, Sissy, curious, held things up to the light. "Come," she said to Coggins, "and see what I am take out AR. Come and see tomorrow." And Coggins slowly answered, "Sissy, if yo know what is good for yourself, you best leave dem stones alone." Topic: Panama Gold. 1. Sun was slowly dying. Ella, a switch in her hand, rounded up her chicks. Cocks came proudly in, puffed by poise and conquest. Hens, agitated, jealous of their young, clucked in, furious at the disappearance of a one-eyed one caught by the leg and dragged down the hole of a mongoose. "Yo go up, dear, and behave yourself. Swish, swish, swish. I know you had to be last, you go rascal yo, jump inside. Guinea fowl, swifter than a hare, wild as any of the Gapas tabbies." The wind subsided. Butterfish clung to the sky, fish in the sky, mullets, garfish, butterfish. Fish, blue, gold, black, orange, tossing on a sea, floundering around in goddess sky. Fishermen at low road, set their nets by the twilight visions, mirrored in the sky, of the lore rolling drunk on the sea's bottom. They were dark sea rats, streaming out at twilight to embark on some intrepid quest. She would be alone at dusk, cooking, mixing flour, or tasting broth. Why taste it, why? It no foe, me alone. Yampies, Edo's, plantains. To Bajan man him say, Ella smiled, plantain and saltfish me don't want, and to mudhead man him say, me wish me had And moisture came to Ella's laughing eyes. From the plantains to the corn and the flour dumplings. One o' dem would knock a man in a cock hat, she observed. A man, a man. All of a sudden a problem arose. God I and me got a bit o' salt in de house. No saw, she cried frantically. Me can't stand no fresh food, me must get a pinch o' salt. 2. Yo mommy inside, Cappadocia? Ella paused, before the dalrymple cabin. Even the mangy brindle pup with his ears sticking sickly up row road, hoarsely after the spunky downpour of rain. I is talking to you, girl. And Cappadocia, still pricking the chigger fester in her thumb, hollowed, mommy? Don't ye too and yo back pon me, girl, before I tell yo mommy. Unruly, Cappadocia. Cappadocia, what is it? Miss Heath, hey a mum she want yo. Skimpy-legged Cappadocia, the color of a warm chestnut, freckles dominant on her rude, glazed, hard little face. Hey, des a children, Lizzie. Ella stepped over to Cappadocia's mother. Hey, I asked de gal if she mommy home and Lizzie, yo know what she tell ma, why de little rapscallion too and me she backside and didn't he even say ax yo pardon. Come in here, miss, come in here and two and round. Ax Miss Heath pardon. Ax she yo wanty, yo wretch. Vagabond. Take dat and dat and dat, shut up I says. Shut up before I box evy one o dem teats down yo t wrote. Didn't he I tell yo not to be rude? Shut up, yes, didn't he I tell yo not to be unmannerly to people that yo must respect de neighbors? Like she a and d got no manners. Shut up I says before I hamstring yo, yo little whelp. Desse gal picnies nowadays is noof to send yo to de madhouse. Hey but Lizzie, what we gwine do wit de children ne? Evie, why day is getting wusser and wusser. Lord only knows Suli gal, dat Miss Cappadocia yo wait till she pappy come home. He gwine beat she fo true. Ella drew near the cabin door, near enough to be able to spy through the blue smoke of Lizzie Dalrymple's cooking, Cappadocia cutting her eyes at her and murmuring, come complainin' pon me, de old hag, why she don't go and get yourself a man? And how yo ni? Cried Ella, turning to Lizzie and coloring brightly. How yo? Oh so, Suli gal, I still got de rheumatics in me leg. Yo ain't be doin' not ing far writ, no? Hey gal, yo ain't frightened, no? Yo ain't afraid o de horse petrol, no? Come in and sit down, Ella, and res yourself. Don't put yourself out o de way, Lizzie, on account o me. Are woos just gwine ask yo to lend me a pinch o salt, when dat gal chili o yours skin up she behin at me. A body can't even talk to children nowadays. Tell yo de truth, Ella, Lizzie answered. I just used to lost drop myself to sweeten Christian's coffee. It make he coffee taste good. And how s Christian Suli? Oh so chili. He still at de quarry? Yes, ol. Well, I gwine go back down de gap. I left a pot boilin'. Yes, Suli gal, I just shelled de bonavis and put dem in, and in course de dumplings will tek long fo swell up. Which call to mind, dat Los Ebonin Christian bring home a bag o' soup crabs from Miss Falk's de buckra. She are always givin' him soup meat or pepper soup, or crab fo soup fo tek away. Howsomever.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.